very much, Anne. So as I guess for everybody, what you can see here in black is the title from Andrea. So we had some constraint, but I slipped a little bit of TEM inside. So thank you very much for this invitation plus the title. So that's really everything we can hope. So creep. It's very good because I don't have to do any introduction because of the great talk of Lars that we had yesterday, who really set all the landscape, and on many aspects my little music today will try to give some echo to a few points. I cannot cover everything, all the dashpots and springs that we saw, but I hope that you will recognize some links in between what he said yesterday and what I will try also to highlight from my point of view today. So creep is not easy because it's not a property, it's a behavior. So this is really what makes things complicated, because there is not a single answer of the material. The material will answer depending on how you ask the question. Usually what we consider to be, well, the creep is, we discussed semantics several times, and there are many aspects behind that and many meanings behind the word of creep, but a simple thing is just the deformation, usually at high temperature. We saw yesterday that it's not always the case under a constant load. And even with this simple curve here, you can see that, well, steady state is one aspect, but it's not only that. There can be different kind of regime and so on and so on. This is not what I'm going to discuss right now. What I want to show is what will be my approach today. It's not going from that and multiplying this kind of experiments and curves and trying from that to reach a landscape or an understanding. It's more trying to see what's behind and what is, well, behind, we know what's behind dashpots and springs, but behind the springs and the dashpots are rocks, minerals, which are made of atoms, and in fact also, since we are dealing with mechanical properties, with electrons, because ultimately the electrons give the properties. So that is right, what I'm saying right now is okay, except that it's not useful, because, well, I ignore many, many things, but the only thing that I know is that, contrary to elasticity, for instance, elasticity, it works. You can start from the electrons, solve Schrödinger equation, and then you have the elastic properties. But that's not true for plastic deformation, that's not true for creep. There are many, many things which occur in between the scale of the ultimate particle, the electrons, and the property. So this is the way we tried. This is our dashpots and springs, well, just part of them, but this is the way we, with others, try to separate and to have different scales and also different intermediate mechanisms. So we think that we have to describe the defects, the crystal defects, because it's not a single crystal, it's crystal with defects. The electrons are behind, I don't mention them right now, but ultimately we use the ab initio calculation to set some properties, so the electrons are taken into account. We model the defects, we try to model their dynamics and their collective behavior, and this is where it becomes quite complicated. Those defects, I will mostly discuss about dislocations today, but there is a lot of things to be done on grand boundaries, and we heard about that yesterday as well. And then, of course, this has to be brought upscale, these stress problems, long range and so on, at the scale of polycrystal, and then up and up. So this is the kind of thing that we try to address in the project that was funded by the ERC. Of course, I was not alone to do that. There was a big team with Philippe Carrez playing a very important role in the numerical modeling. Today, I will speak a little bit about Olivine, so for the work of Francesca and Srinivasan, a little bit of TEM, and I will speak also about abridgmentite and the low mantle. I will not cover all the aspects, of course. So dislocations, I will mostly discuss the behavior of those defect dislocations. First of all, they do exist. We can see them at the TEM. That was not obvious from the very beginning. This is a very important year where those three gentlemen proposed independently the concept of dislocation as an agent for plastic deformation. Dislocation were already introduced in continuum mechanics, but what was really important at that time was to identify the fact that the motion, the propagation of dislocation was really carrying plastic deformation. So 1934, and basically in the 50s, most of the theory was set, and that is really amazing. You mentioned yesterday the book of Poirier, Creep of Crystals, which is still, I think, a really good book, also because it makes a very clear distinction in between what is phenomenological and what is the theory, and not mixing everything together, which is important. Of course, if we speak about dislocation, this book is a monument by Hirth, John, not Greg, and others. It's a lifetime to be able to read this book. All the equations are there. I mention that because it's very important when I speak about numerical modeling. It's a myth to imagine that you can just throw atoms into a box, shake, and get plastic deformation and go up scales. We need theories, and it's because we have those theories that we are able to introduce at different layers, at different stages, what we need. So we really rely on that, and I think that it's really a revolution that now we can put that at play. This theory can be put at work, really. And this series by Frank Nabarro and Herve as well, a series of books which covers a wide range of properties of dislocation, but there are others. But just to say that this is extremely important to have that, because we are not going to invent all the concepts. Dislocation, as I said, they participate to plastic deformation because they move. So it's a dynamic property, which you cannot see here. This is a simple sketch that we can see usually with a dislocation represented as an extra half plane, which is gliding by breaking bonds successively and moving through the crystal to propagate plastic shear. For a long time, I've been only looking at dead bodies, at dead dislocation like that, but very recently I had the privilege, and I hope you will see something, yes, here. I had the privilege to be able in situ in the TEM to deform a sample of olivine and to see actually those dislocation loops which are expanding, and while they are moving, while they are gliding, they are propagating a little bit of shear. This is a very small experiment. This is 4 micrometers. This is 1 micrometer and half a micrometer in thickness. So this is smaller than a red blood cell. And this is done in situ in the TEM. So it's nice to see them moving, but the goal is just not just that, because otherwise it's a little bit mesmerizing. The goal is to make measurements, and this is what you can do here, because the mechanics is quite clean in tension. It's possible to measure the position of the dislocation as a function of time, and then to derive the velocity and to see, for instance, here how it varies with stress. This is a very important parameter that we need when we want to model dislocation. I'm not going to go into the details of that. So just reminding that this is the basics of dislocation glide. A loop, schematic here, the loop is in what we call the glide plane, that is a plane which contains the loop and the Burgers vector. And when stress is applied, the loop is expanding. It's not moving, it's expanding. And by expanding, it's producing plastic shear. Okay, so this is the basics. But that's not all, because, and that was mentioned yesterday, we need many, many dislocations to do something significant, because dislocation is just producing like 5 angstrom of shear, which is very small. And since there are a lot of dislocations, since they have stress field, they see each other, they interact, and those interactions that were mentioned yesterday, they are quite important. This is here a single crystal of olivine. In principle, it's quite simple, long, straight, screw dislocation, but you see that the fast edge dislocation, they start to see each other at some point. And they start to interact, and here they slow down, and they form a dipole. And if it stays, then there is another one, and you build up entanglements. And then you jam the structure, and you prevent further dislocation to glide and to go through the crystal. So this is this kind of interaction. We can make study out of that. We developed recently electron tomography of dislocation, because we only see projections of the microstructure, and sometimes it's not easy to see. And look at this part, which is represented here. It's a monster, because it's not what I described previously. It's not a loop within a plane. You see that it's not planar. And by the tomography, we could understand, in fact, the story. At the beginning, there was one dislocation, which is green here, a C dislocation, and it was crossed by two dislocations with opposite Burgers vector, minus C, gliding in different planes, and at the point where they met, there is a reaction, and this reaction is an annihilation. So basically you have nothing here, and this is a lock, so this is a very efficient interaction. This is a mechanism that has been ignored for a long time, even in metals, but that we could see also acting in olivine. Okay, so that was a spring, isn't it? Building internal stress. So we need the dashpot, which is able to relax a little bit the microstructure and to allow things to go further. So if we look closely to the microstructure, we see small things like that, small loops. And these loops are bizarre because such small loops, they should not be stable in glide, they should collapse. Because these are not gliding loops, and we can understand where they come from. They are in fact residues of recovery mechanism. When you have a dipole like that, it's not a stable configuration. If there is some diffusion, we are at 900 degrees. It's not very fast, but on short distances it can work. If you have diffusion, then you have instability on the dislocation line that you can see here, pinching, and then it forms a string of loops which shrinks progressively as long as point defects are diffusing toward the dislocation loops. So you can see here the string of loops. You see here just before the pinching is occurring here, just at the right time where it's occurring, and all the strings which occur like that. So okay, this is a dashpot. But it can be also spring, because this is a slow process, and it takes time to occur. And depending on the strain rate that you apply, the temperature, and so on. And also, if they don't disappear fast enough, those dislocation loops are very efficient to pin dislocation as well. So they also can contribute to hardening, even if they are recovery mechanism. And this is also something we could see. This is, again, a quite complex microstructure with a dislocation with a very complex shape. But when we do the tomography, we can identify, for instance, here this strange segment of dislocation. And when we turn, we see that, in fact, it's the remnant of interaction between a dislocation loop and the dislocation. And this is one of these hardening and interaction mechanisms. Okay. But that's not all the story. So if we look now at this kind of complex microstructure, again by electron tomography, the colors here are given by the plane where we find the dislocation lines. And you can see that we see many colors, and also that even, you know, a simple case like that, there are two colors. It means that, and you can see it when it turns, it's not belonging to a single plane. So this is quite complex, and this is not what we did anticipate by the small drawing I made previously. And this is because there is something else than glide. To be more specific, these are indication of segments belonging to 111 plane, and that cannot be a glide plane for any dislocation in olivine. So this is an indication of something else, and this something else is climb. There is another mobility which is possible for dislocation, but not only under the action of stress, which is glide. But if there is diffusion, and I showed that there was indeed some diffusion, if there is diffusion, a vacancy can diffuse, can move to the dislocation core, and be absorbed by the dislocation line, and then this part of the dislocation is able to move up as a response of this absorption. And it's able to leave the glide plane. The glide plane here is horizontal, as you could see on the small GIF animation previously. Okay, so this is another mechanism where the dislocation is able slowly, under the influence of diffusion, to escape its glide plane. There is a velocity which depends not only on stress here, and that's important. It, of course, depends on the flux of vacancies which are falling, the rain of vacancies on the dislocation through the diffusion coefficient. So it's a different dynamics, if you like. Okay, so now what is creep? A creep, when we try to put things together, it's not possible to put things together with all the complexity, especially of the geometry and so on at this stage. But we have dislocation dynamics, and you mentioned that yesterday, where we can have a first approach, simplified approach of that, being able to model the collective behavior, taking into account the fact that we have two dynamics which are playing together and which are interacting. So we have all those dislocations, which are just represented by segments, linear segments. They have glide planes. What is more important is that they can either glide or climb. And what is really important is to really compare those two dynamics. And we do that with this kind of plot, which is the ratio of the glide over the climb velocity. And you see here where it's really important for us to have those values, those information. So if we plot the ratio, you can see that here, whatever the stress and the temperature, it's all blue and even dark blue, which means that glide is always much, much faster than climb. That's an important point. That's also a difficulty for the modeling because we have to handle two very different time scales in the model, but we have tricks to do that. Okay, so the nice thing also with modeling that we can play and we can do not what we want, but we can adjust some kind of behavior. The first thing we can do is introduce at first a population of dislocation and first say, well, you can just glide, no climb, and apply stress here for the MPA and see what happens. There is some strain, but very rapidly it saturates. Very rapidly, dislocation, they make this interaction, and it's not possible to deform anymore in creep, that is, with this constant load. If we would want to deform more, it would be necessary to increase the stress. So this is hardening. But here, the stress is constant, so nothing happens. So we turn on climb, and then the behavior is completely different, and we have a steady state here with the plastic strain, which evolves linearly with time. And we can plot the strain rate as a function of the reciprocal temperature and find the activation enthalpy, which, like in experiment, it's close to the one which was introduced for diffusion. We can look for the stress exponent, which is about 3. These are quite regular behavior of a power law creep in those conditions. Here's the stress, the maximum stress that is used is 100 MPa. I will come back on that. So it was absolutely necessary to have climb for the process to occur. But does that mean that climb is producing strain? Here, what you have in blue is the total plastic strain, and we could separate the contribution of glide in green and of climb in red. And you can see that climb is not producing strain. All the strain is produced by glide. But climb is allowing the process to further occur by the recovery, and this is where it's important. So this is basically the kind of drawing that Wirtmann in the 50s proposed for this creep with sources, with dislocation and interaction, annihilation, and so on and so on. What can we say more? Not much, but what is important is to realize that it's a mixture of local and non-local interaction. We have local interaction or kind of local interaction because it can be a dipole, but here you probably can't see, but there are two crosses, a gray and a black one, so two dislocations which are pinned at the same place. And if we wait long enough by climb and diffusion, this can annihilate, and when it will annihilate, it will change the stress field around, those colors will change, and it will free, I don't know, 3, 5, 10 dislocations, which will continue until the next stop point, and so on and so on. So this is a stop and go process, which is really a discussion between local and non-local interactions, which allow creep to progressively proceed. Okay. I showed results below 100 MPa. We carried out also experiments at larger stresses. So whatever the temperature here, it's just a part of the curve. We have this power law that I described previously. But when we increase the stress, and this is necessary when we try to model low temperature creep because the strain rate is extremely low. In that case, we see a deviation, which is usually called the power law breakdown. So we see that there is a continuous change of the response, of the apparent behavior, where the power law is not describing anymore the behavior of the creep, but then, as it's been proposed, it can be described by, for instance, an exponential equation like that. But this equation could describe actually the whole process, but I think that Fanny will speak about that. Okay, so this is basically the first part, and I wanted to discuss mostly what would be the normal creep mechanism, behaviors, Wirtmann creep, if you like. And I will try now to see how it applies to other minerals for the lower mantle, and I will speak only about the bridgmanite today. So the question now is more what is the mechanism of mantle convection? This is an easy question. I will not try to do the test today, but if we ask this question, everybody knows. Everybody has an answer, but not always the same answer depending on the people. Of course, for some people, depending on the papers, it can vary and be one or the other. So dislocation creep, this is what I did describe previously. There is diffusion creep, where plastic deformation is just made by transporting matter, that is vacancies, from one side to a grain to another side of the grain. So there are pros and cons about those two possibilities. Both have been found in experiments depending on the conditions which were applied. The problem with diffusion creep is that it needs very, very small grains, because diffusion is slow, and especially when you go at high pressure. seismic and isotropy is not favored in the lower mantle for dislocation creep, so still matter to discuss. Experimentally, of course, the lower in the mantle, the higher the pressure, the more difficult it is. But there has been recently several technical developments which allowed to make experiments, and especially on bridgmanite or assemblages containing bridgmanite, those two papers recently have been able to produce deformation experiments at the shallower part of the lower mantle. I will just describe this one from Girard et al., because we did have a look at that at the TEM. So this is the rotational Drickhammer apparatus that they used. These are the conditions. Please note that the temperature is very high. And this is a mixture of ferropericlase and bridgmanite. Even if the temperature is extremely high, you can see that the stresses are very high as well. And this is really surprising. Here, this is the bridgmanite, this is the ferropericlase. We are at the order of a few GPa to be able to deform this bridgmanite. This is a sample that we looked at the TEM. I'm not going to spend a lot of time. This is the ECOM-TEM. This is like EBSD, if you like, in the TEM, where here the color is representing the orientation of the grains. What is black is the ferropericlase, which has been removed in this picture, so you can just concentrate on the bridgmanite. On this thin foil, there were basically two large grains of bridgmanite, which have been intruded by this ferropericlase. You can see that this is pink, but not always the same pink. This is blue, but not always the same blue. So if we plot here the derivative of the orientation, we can have more, so the distribution of misorientation, we have a more clear view of the fact that indeed bridgmanite has been deformed. There are some internal misorientation in bridgmanite. But when we look at the TEM, bridgmanite is partially preserved, not completely. There are several amorphous lamellae, and we didn't see dislocation well. We saw three dislocations. That's it. And we could show that all the plastic deformation was in fact localized on shear on these amorphous lamellae. So this is really an indication that this is very strong, and that contrary to ferropericles, for instance, for which at much lower stresses it's full, it's completely jammed and full by dislocations. Okay, so let's see what numerical modeling can say about that. So this is again how we do it. We first have to model the defects, and to model the defect at the atomic scale, we could say, well, why do we need to know those tiny details about arrangements of atoms around the core? But I will try to convince you that it's important. Then it's important to model the mobility, and then to put everything together. Different sophistication levels are available. I will only show the simplest one today. Okay, so modeling the defect, this is possible, but this is still difficult because since a dislocation has a stress field, whatever the size of the box you will use, the atoms on the side will have some displacement. So we cannot do that with very small simulation cells, which means that we cannot model directly that with ab initio calculation. We need to do that with molecular statics or using empirical potential, which means, and I'm not describing that today, but we need to anchor that before with ab initio calculation to be sure of the relevance of what we do. So there are several possibilities to overcome this difficulty of the stress field. One is to introduce a dislocation here. It can be a very thin slab because of the periodicity along the dislocation line. Here it has to be big, and we can fix the atoms far away at the edges of the box. Or we can use this kind of trick, which is using distribution of dislocation with different signs, and then we have some possibilities to remove the elastic interaction energy, which is huge in that case, but which can be calculated accurately because of the periodicity of the distribution. Well, this means that we have possibilities to calculate dislocation. This is how it what it looks like in Bridgmanite, and you see that, well, even if it's a defect, it's not glass in the dislocation core. We can reconstruct bonds. Of course, it's different. It's a defect, so the crystal structure locally is different, but it's quite clean, it's quite nice. Also, what you can see is that it's very narrow. I'm not going into the detail, but this immediately gives indication for us about the mechanical properties. For instance, diamond dislocation are very narrow, and diamond is very strong. And why is aluminum very weak? It's because dislocation spreading. So this is an indication already without doing calculation. But we can do calculation, and what we want to calculate is lattice friction that was mentioned yesterday. And there are different ways to do that. The most simple to explain is the most brutal one. We can just apply a shear to the simulation cell and see what happens by increments. First, we have this parabolic evolution, which means that we store elastic energy into the system. And at some point, there is an accident, and this drop here corresponds to the point where the dislocation make a step where it starts to move. So this gives an indication about the threshold that the lattice is opposing to the motion of the dislocation. Since Bridgmanite is stable over a large range in the mantle, it was possible to explore the influence of pressure, and it's huge, as you can see. Well, this is already quite high, but across the lower mantle we have a factor of 3 or 4 or something like that. So this means that when we apply these high pressures, we really have a strong effect on the lattice friction, the mechanical properties through here, the lattice friction. This is only for screw dislocation. Let me show you other dislocation, edge dislocation. This depends on the orientation of the Burgers vector and the dislocation line. The core is a little bit different, but it's kind of interesting to see. The edge dislocation, contrary to the screw, is a little bit spread. It forms a little ribbon. I don't know if you can see, but here you have two octahedra which are sharing an edge, where here they are sharing corners. So this is a dislocation core here. This is in bridgmanite, and this is something that is common to all perovskite structure materials. And this is something which is found also, for instance, in strontium titanate, which has been very, very much studied. Because here it's cubic, because there are no distortion, no tilting of the octahedra. Here it's more easy to produce a stacking fault, so the spread is more wide, but it's basically the same. It's very interesting because, as I said, when a dislocation is spreading, it's more mobile, and it's very surprising that strontium titanate, although it's a ceramic, is ductile even at low temperature. It's the only ceramic that you can really deform at ambient temperature so easily. But there is something very strange which has been discovered by this group in the beginning of the century, is that contrary to what you can expect, when you increase the temperature, it's not weakening, it's hardening. And it's hardening so badly that it becomes brittle. So you have an inverse ductile brittle transition in this material. Why? Because of the dislocation cores. Because when you increase temperature, you see that you change the dislocation core. If you remember here, there was a spreading here horizontally in the glide plane. When you increase temperature, the spreading is now vertical, which means that the dislocation cannot move anymore. It's not spread in the plane where it's supposed to glide. And this is something that occurs also on the strontium titanate, and that has been observed at the TEM as well, and this is the origin of this very strong hardening mechanism which is here. So we could even calculate the energy barrier in between those two configurations. Of course, when it's wider, it's more difficult to reach this configuration because first you have to constrict the dislocation before it goes on the other direction. It's more easy with the bridgmanite here, and there is almost no barrier opposed to that. Spontaneously, it goes to this configuration. This is under the influence of temperature, but pressure also does that. And this is here what we could see with the edge dislocation, where just by increasing pressure, no temperature, we reach this climb, this is the name, this climb configuration, and then, well, we break the box, but there's no way to make the dislocation glide anymore. Let me just point out that here the dislocation is spread into the glide plane. It's just ready to glide. But here, it's in the starting blocks to climb. It cannot glide anymore, it cannot move by glide, but it's just in the right position to continue to climb. Important. So the mobility, I'm speaking about the glide part. Again, the mobility is something that we cannot model just by doing molecular dynamics, because the time scale to have a dislocation moving from one position to another, especially when lattice friction is so important, the time scale is far, far longer than what is available in molecular dynamics. So we need, again, to change scale and to change tools. So we need to identify the mechanism, and the mechanism is this one. It's not possible just by thermal activation to throw all the atoms of a dislocation in the next position, but it's possible on a small portion. Under the vibration of the dislocation line, a small loop is able to overcome the energy barrier and to go to the next position. We call that a king pair, the king pair mechanism. So this is something that we can calculate also at the atomic scale, that we can model, parameterize, and for which we can calculate the nucleation enthalpy. And it's very important to realize that it depends on stress. So this is the evolution of the nucleation enthalpy as a function of stress. And when we have that, so by doing several calculations at the atomic scale, different kind of calculation, then we can put that together to derive a velocity of the dislocation, because velocity, well, the possibility of the dislocation to go from one position to another depends on the probability of a successful jump of a king pair over the energy barrier, and this depends on this that we did calculate. It depends also on the number of dislocation sites, which depends on the spacing which is allowed between those king pairs, and also on the vibration frequency, which depends also on the size. So these are all things that we can calculate, so we can get the velocity of the dislocation in glide here. if we put that together to have the flow laws, well, it's interesting because we can make some first and crude comparison with the experiments. Of course, what we have is only the contribution of single slip systems, because here this is glide, but you can see that the agreement with the few experiments which are available is quite fair, especially if we speak about orders of magnitude, and this is what we should keep in mind. Again, you know, this is striking that at more than 2000 degrees we are speaking about stresses which are several GPAs. This does not exist in material science. You know, we have no material which is able to sustain such kind of stresses at high temperatures. So this is really amazing. Of course, to make the comparison, we use laboratory strain rates, and this is something that, well, I did not go into details, but the strain rate is inside the equation, so we don't have to extrapolate. We can just make now the calculation at a different strain rate, for instance, something which is more representative to mantle convection. And of course, the stress is decreased, because if you wait longer, it's just a probability factor which depends on stress. So if you wait longer, you don't need that much stress, so you can do the same at a lower stress. So we have a decrease indeed, but it's not enough, because you see that still we are of the order of the GPA, so still the lattice friction that is opposed to glide or those dislocation in Bridgmanite here is at 60 GPA, and it, as you could see, it increases very, very strongly with pressure. So now what about creep? How can we do creep with Bridgmanite? So what I propose is to keep the same strategy as we did with olivine. You remember this kind of plot where we were comparing the relative mobility of dislocations in glide and in climb. So this is the ratio of glide over climb. We can do the same. I just presented the calculation of the glide velocity. We can calculate also the climb velocity, provided that we know the diffusion coefficient. I will come back on that. And this is what we have. And now, if you have in mind, if you remember what I was showing on the olivine, the case of olivine, which corresponds to the Wirtmann creep, is when glide is much, much faster than climb. And this is something that does occur, and that we find, but we find it only at very high stresses, a few GPA. This is exactly consistent with the observation we made at the TM or with the previous calculation. But in the mantle here, we have a completely different regime. These numbers do not mean anything. They just mean that, well, the dislocation, they cannot glide. And you remember this dislocation which moved, which shifted its configuration, and which was completely in the opposite direction. So now it's at the same time more simple and more complicated. More simple because we are left with only one mechanism, which is climb. More complicated because so far dislocation creep involves both, and because we know that in dislocation creep, strain is produced by glide, and we don't have glide anymore. So is climb able to provide enough strain when it's alone? That is the question. In fact, it's not a new problem, and this is something that has been proposed and discussed in the literature by Frank Nabarro in 1967, and several papers after that, where creep can be produced by pure climb being... it's an equivalent, if you like, of diffusion creep, where strain is produced by exchanging vacancies and atoms between sources and sinks. In diffusion creep, sources and sinks are the edges of the grains, which means that the distance has to be controlled by the grain size, and this is where the grain size is so important and can become a problem when diffusion is slow. Here we just introduce an internal microstructure, an internal length scale, which is of course smaller because it's inside. Dislocation are sources and sinks, and when one is moving one direction, the other one is moving the other, and we can deform the crystal by pure shear, exactly as in the case of the diffusion creep. This is the expression that has been derived and proposed by Frank Nabarro in 1967. pure climb creep is just like creep. The first problem which always occurs is, but how do you multiply dislocation? You need sources, and in fact, these sources in glide, the name is Frank Reed mechanism. In climb, it's Barden and Herring, because those guys did propose this kind of source. And in fact, it's the first observation that has been made in aluminum. And it's a very nice source where you see all those loops which are produced. And it's such a nice micrograph that there is one book on dislocation theory which shows this one, showing that this is a Frank Reed source. But no, in fact, because we don't have so nice sometimes pictures of Frank Reed sources, but this is a Barden and Herring source. Climb source we have been observed also in magnesium, so this is an important thing to realize. Pure climb creep has already been observed when in our case we have to turn to pure climb creep, because glide is not possible because of lattice friction, because of pressure. Here it's completely different. This is magnesium. Magnesium dislocation can glide easily in the basal plane. So if you stress along the C-axis, and if you inhibit glide in the basal plane, and this is what Edelin, Levy, and Poirier did in the 70s, well, you can then activate those nice Barden-Herring sources and deformed by pure climb creep. This has been done also by Arthur Hoyer on Sapphire in the 70s as well. It's the same, you know, it's rhombohedral, but if you deform along the C-axis, then you inhibit glide and slip systems, and then you can promote plastic deformation by pure climb. In perovskite, Poirier, when he was looking for this analog series of plastic deformation, he did suggest that there were some indications, but they did not push very, very far, but there were some indication of pure climb strain in potassium tantalate perovskite. And also recently in quasicrystals, we also found that quasicrystals have very strange behavior. You know, quasicrystals have quasiplanes, of course, which are extremely corrugated, and because of this corrugation, dislocation glide is very, very difficult. So it's a very good analog to perovskite, to bridgmanite, actually. And at low temperature, quasicrystals are brittle, but at high temperature, they are ductile and they are deformed by pure climb motion of dislocation, and this has been seen also in situ in the TEM. So let's go back to this proposition by Frank Nabarro of pure climb creep that he called steady state diffusional creep. It changed the vocabulary, is not constant and not very, very clear. So this is the expression that he proposed. We did try also to check by dislocation dynamics, since we have the model that was ready to use. I showed you first that we choose to switch off climb and have only glide, but we can do the opposite, of course. And we could see that indeed, yes, it works. The exchange of vacancy between dislocation and the possibility of having a steady state creep. If we compare the expression by Nabarro, which is here, and the results here of Francesca Boioli by dislocation dynamics, the agreement is quite fair, so we can rely on this expression. Interesting, well, it's a little bit discovering obvious things, but if we try to compare diffusion creep and dislocation creep, basically dislocation creep, pure climb creep is always more efficient because the distance is smaller because it's inside the grains. The only limit is that we cannot push the pure climb creep to smaller and smaller grains, because we need some space to open the sources. And there is, like in the Frank Reed sources, a stress which is opposed to that. So when it becomes too small, then the stress would be too high. So there is a limit which is, I don't know, like here, half a millimeter or something like that, a few hundred microns, which does not vary very much with temperature and pressure. We tried different kind of things. Okay, so now what can we do and how far can we push that? Now it becomes difficult because, you know, a model is not better than the parameters that we put into the model. And this is where we are facing difficulties. We are lacking parameters. Everything is now controlled by diffusion. Do we know diffusion in Bridgmanite? Not so well. We know a few things. We know that oxygen diffusion is faster. There seems to be a consistent observation about that. Magnesium and silicon seem to be quite comparable, so we have to rely on those diffusion coefficient. The point is that we don't have, if we want to try to infer the rheology of the lower mantle, we don't have these values of the diffusion coefficient for all the pressures and temperatures of the lower mantle. So we did something which is a little bit composite. The diffusion coefficient can be derived from the diffusivity of the vacancies and the concentration of the vacancies. Why do we do that? Because the diffusivity of the vacancies is something that can be calculated at the atomic scale, and actually this has been done quite well by Amann and others in the range of pressure of the lower mantle. But then we don't know the vacancy concentration because it depends on impurities, it depends on the other phases and so on and so on. So we just took bounds by comparison with experiments that we could do. What is important to realize, what can be calculated is the intrinsic concentration of vacancies, and this is far too small. You know, there's no way that it can account for the rheology of Bridgmanite, so it has to be extrinsic, and it has to be vacancies depending on, as I say, it can be impurities or whatever. Okay, if we do that, just to try to see how it responds, it's just to attract attention on what is important. What we really plead for is for more studies and more measurements and calculation for diffusivity in Bridgmanite. That's clear, and you can see here we took a range which is quite large, between 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 6, but this is how it varies. What is important to realize, I did not discuss that, I forgot, but in the low Frank Nabarro, let me go back, an important fact is that it's non-linear. There is a stress exponent which is free, so it also depends on the stress in the mantle that we don't know very well also. So this is how we can expect the viscosity to vary. If we do, I don't like very much this exercise because, it can be discussed, but if we compare this kind of range with the viscosity profile, at least what we can say is that the variation that are observed by several authors, also this so kind of peak at 1,000 kilometers or whatever, we don't need to invent different things. We don't need to invent, other materials or the mechanisms or whatever. Just variations which are very acceptable of those parameters can account for that. For a very long time, I was puzzled by this possibility of having a bump or a decrease, because as you could see from the mechanical point of view, everything goes up with pressure, hardening the bonds and so on. And understanding how it could go down from the mechanical point of view was extremely difficult to me, and that was a problem. But from the chemical point of view, why not? You know, and then if you have a change in vacancy concentration between 10 to the minus 4 and 10 to the minus 5 or 6, you can have this kind of behavior. So this is very acceptable. But this is not something that we can predict. This is a problem with chemistry. We cannot predict as easily as with mechanics, which is highly deterministic. Okay, so let me finish and summarize. So we think that pure Klein creep is a mechanism that has been largely ignored, but which can be extremely important in the lower mantle for Bridgmanite, and but also except for planetary interest, because since I was always very concerned about this influence of pressure, which seems to be hardening everything, I think that it's good to have this possibility, this flexibility of the mechanisms to offer another way to achieve plastic deformation. Strain is produced by climb, contrary to Wirtmann creep. I did not discuss that, but it's there's no shear here. Dislocation are climbing, there's no shear, so there's no rotation of the grains in this mechanism. So it does not induce crystal preferred orientation, crystal rotation and crystal preferred orientation, which is very consistent with the absence of strong seismic and isotropy in the bulk of the lower mantle. There is no grain size dependence because the characteristic length scale which controls the rheology is inside the grain, it's the dislocation density, and it's a nonlinear rheology with a stress exponent of 3. And I will finish with this message by thanking you very, very much. And if you're interested, the result of this project I will in this book that is here, but that you can download freely from our website. Thank you very much.